Well, I have the privilege of introducing a friend and a partner and a pastor and our guest speaker this morning. Josh Jordan has been a friend now for many years, actually, for many years, and he really embodies the partnership and the benefit of it that we were just talking about in our broader family of Sovereign Grace. I wanted to kind of describe how he does that in terms of his journey a bit. Josh was a founding member, really, of Grace Church in Frisco, which is just north of Dallas. A number of ladies just went up to this church for the ladies' conference this last spring. Well, the man we're going to have preach this morning was a founding member of that church. After a number of years, he attended the Sovereign Grace Pastors College. He did graduate. Praise God for that, for every student that graduates. He did graduate. And after graduation, rather than coming back to his sending church, which I know that church would have loved to have him and loved him, they invested him in Lifegate Church of Seguin. Lifegate Church in Seguin is, I think, 35 years old now or so. Had for a long period of time been led by Bob Odom as a single staff pastor, and he was in need of assistance and support, and so Grace Church graciously sent Josh to that church, and he has been there now, I think, for eight years, serving them as a pastor. I'm just so grateful for how he represents the benefit that we have of being in a family of churches, and not only that, he does this personally. Josh is a very kind and encouraging man. So last night when I got home and one of my sons was asking me, Dad, how was your meeting? And I love telling him, you know, son, it's so great that Daddy has friends that are pastors. So many pastors don't have friends, but Daddy does. And Josh is one of those friends. Josh is a serious man. He thinks deeply about the scriptures. He's one of those men that can talk to you about a passage that you've read 100 times and can help you see something you didn't see before because he thinks deeply about it. I trust he's going to do that this morning. He's also a faithful pastor. He works tirelessly. What I mean by that is constantly for Lifegate Church of Seguin. And it would be an honor if I lived in Seguin, I would go to Josh's church. And so it is really an honor to have him come preach to us this morning. A word about his topic. We have wanted to insert throughout this year a theme of our devotional life before the Lord. You know we're kind of accenting evangelism in many ways, but we don't want to neglect this theme of our personal encounters with God himself through his word, through prayer, just being with God. And I thought this would be a great topic for Josh to address our church on because he's an example in it, because I think he's going to inspire us towards it. So Josh, and also I just want to introduce the family as well. So if you guys can just raise your hand. So this is Josh's wife, Amanda, and his 3 children right here. So guys, raise your hands real quick so everybody can see you. Can we just welcome both Josh and his family this morning. Josh, come up and serve us with your word, man.
Well, good morning. It is a joy to be with you guys this morning. Thank you for the invitation to not only to join you, but to do the thing that is always a privilege, no matter where I get to speak, to open up God's word and to speak God's word and share God's word with his people is always a privilege. So I am excited this morning to see what the Lord has for us. So if you have a Bible with you, we're going to be in the Gospel according to Luke and the 10th chapter. And in just a moment, we're going to be looking at verses 38 through 42. Gospel according to Luke, chapter 10. And in a moment, we're going to be looking at 38 through 42. You know, by way of introduction, I wanted to share something with you I've been thinking a lot about lately. For whatever reason, this has just really been something that's been resonating in my mind and in my heart. And that's how much Scripture is a gift to us. You know, I don't know about you, but I've grown up in the church. And I've grown up in wonderful churches where God's word was always honored and held in high esteem. And I think part of me growing up in the church is sometimes I have lost sight and have forgotten what a gift Scripture is. And it's a gift for two reasons, primarily. Number one, first and foremost, it's a gift because in the Word, God speaks to us. As the Protestant Reformer says, when Scripture speaks, God speaks. So that's the main reason it is a gift to us. But there's a second reason Scripture's a gift to us. And this is what I've been thinking about a lot lately. You know, God could have given us His Word a lot of ways. But think about this. God gave us His Word in a very specific and special way. The Word of God was written by real people, about real people, for real people. Have you thought about that? God's Word was written by real people like you and me who struggled, who went through doubts and crises and had good moments and low moments. And it was written about real people who struggled. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, you don't find people that are always triumphant, always have their act together. And Scripture was written to real people. There was always an audience. And still to this day, it was written about and to real people. And here's why I wanted to emphasize that on the front end. Because I think one of the precious gifts of Scriptures, besides the fact that it is the Word of God, is that there is a human dynamic to Scripture that we are meant to tap into and to appreciate. And when we tap into it, we benefit greatly. There are deep insights when we pay attention to this human dynamic. And this morning, I don't want us to miss this human dynamic. I want us to remember that the story we're about to read here in a second most likely is familiar. If you've grown up in the church, if you have any familiarity with the Scriptures, you've probably heard the story of Mary and Martha. So we're already in some ways in danger of thinking, I know that. That has been my response to this text for so long. But I think there's another reason we could miss the depth of insight that we can gain from this story, and that's that we treat this story as if Mary and Martha weren't real people. Almost as if Jesus was just telling a parable like he was in the passage before, and he was telling the story, and he's like, well, there's these two women, and well, one was named Mary and one was named Martha. No, these were real people. This woman, Martha, is a woman that I want us this morning to relate to, because over the last few weeks, I've been able to relate to her. And here's one of the things that struck me as I was just reviewing this story and going back over. Martha, in this story, is not at her best. We find Martha, this woman who genuinely loved Jesus, as we will see in a moment. We see her in a vulnerable moment. See if you can relate. Here she is in this vulnerable moment where she says what she feels, and in the process, she criticizes two people she deeply loves and desires to serve. Have you ever done something like that? In seeking to serve, you get stressed out or anxious or upset, and the very people you're seeking to serve, you end up criticizing or becoming upset with. That's Martha in this story that we're about to read. So I wanted to draw our attention to it before we read it and before we get in, because I don't want us to just hear the voice of the Lord. I also want us to hear the human dynamic and sense that in this story, because I think as soon as we can relate to Martha, we will benefit far more from this passage. So let's read it together. Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Hear the word of the Lord. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed her into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. Let me pray for us and ask the Lord to just bless our time. Father, you love us in so many ways, and we have already just sought to express our gratitude, our awareness of your goodness to us in song. And Father, now as we come to your word, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for giving us your word. It is a gift to us. I pray now that we will benefit from it. So Lord, would you help us as we hear your word, that we would be able to hear your voice speaking to our hearts and to our minds and into our lives. Not so that we can leave with some application point to do, but so that we can leave this morning encountering you and being transformed by you. Lord, would you do that for us this morning? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, here's how I want us to come at this passage this morning. I want to kind of take it in three parts. And I want to start with Martha's complaint. Because really at the heart of this story is Martha's complaint. So the first thing I want us to do is I really want us to listen to Martha's complaint here in verse 40. Because if you lose sight of her complaint, I think you'll miss the point of the whole story. And I think over the years, as I have heard this story, read this story, that I have missed what was really at the heart of this story. And one of the reasons I think I've missed the central focus of this story is I haven't seen that Martha's complaint is really what this whole story is beginning to be built upon. So let's listen to what Martha says to the Lord. Verse 40, but Martha was distracted with much serving, and so she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Three things, really, Martha's saying in this complaint that are important to understand. The first one is she's questioning Jesus's discernment. Have you thought about that? The first person she criticizes, we think, is Mary. It's not. It's Jesus. And the irony, she first words out of her mouth is, Lord, you're the Lord. You're the ruler of the universe, but I don't like what you're doing. I disagree with you. You're missing this tragedy that's going on, this injustice. Here I am serving while my sister sits there and you do nothing. So Martha is first questioning Jesus' discernment. She says to him, do you not care? And she's not asking it as a question. It is a statement. It is an indictment. Meaning, obviously, you don't. And then she questions Mary's decision. She says, why is it that she's sitting here while I'm serving and she's left me alone? And then Martha makes a request. Really, it's more than a request. It's a demand. She says to Jesus, tell her to help me. So here is Martha working hard to serve Jesus. And in the midst of it, she begins to be upset. And the first person she goes to voice her complaint is to Jesus. Not just to tell him, I'm upset with Mary, but first and foremost, I'm upset with you. How could you let her do this? How could you let her sit here while I am serving in the kitchen? Now, here's why I think this is so important that we understand that this Martha's complaint is central to the story. Because I, for so long, have understood this story to be about Martha and her serving, almost as if the story was, how could Martha be serving at a time like this? I mean, here's Jesus in your living room, and you're serving, but nobody's questioning Martha. No one is saying to Martha, how could you serve at a time like this? It's actually Mary who is the one that's being questioned. How could she be sitting at a time like this? See, it's Martha's the one who's doing the criticizing. And her critique is of Mary. See, no one's saying to Martha, not Jesus, not Mary, no one is saying, Martha, how in the world could you be making biscuits in the kitchen when Jesus is serving the bread of life in the living room? And for some reason, for so long, I grew up thinking that's what this story was about. But once again, it's Martha who's doing the criticizing. It's not Jesus, and it's not Mary. And I think that's central to what's happening here in this story. So that's the first thing we had to see, is we had to listen to Martha's complaint. Now I want us to pay attention to Luke's description of the story. Luke gives us some descriptive terms in here. The way he talks about this story really helps us understand. Now that we've centered ourselves on Martha's complaint, now it's important that we go back and we look at some of the details that Luke gives us about what's really happening in this story. And here's the first thing I want to draw our attention to, and that's Martha's service. Martha's service. It's easy to misread this story and see Martha's service in a negative light. But remember again, I know I'm beating this drum for just a second. No one's criticizing Martha for her service. That's not the point of the story. If anything, Martha's service is commendable. Martha's service is no small thing. Her act of service is a tangible expression of care to the Savior. Remember, Jesus has no income. He has no home. He relies on the hospitality of people just like Martha. What Martha is doing is wonderful. Did you notice how the passage began? It says in verse 38 that while Jesus was entering this village, a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. Martha's actually out there as Jesus is passing through and says, hey, why don't you come into my house? Let me take care of you. It's not just that he shows up at her house. Here's Martha looking to serve the Lord. This is a commendable act. What hospitality. And then we're told in verse 4, here's another one of those descriptive words, that she's serving the Lord. She's serving him. And this is an important term to understand what Luke is communicating. Back in chapter 8, Luke has told us about a group of women who have become disciples of Jesus after one of them had demons cast out of her, others were physically healed by Jesus, and now these women follow him, and Luke's the only one that tells us this. He not only names them by name, but he tells us that they gave out of their financial means to provide for Jesus. And that word provide in chapter 8 and the word serve here in chapter 10, verse 40 are the same word that we get our word deacon from. These ladies in chapter 8 and Martha here in chapter 10, you know what they're doing? They're ministering to Jesus. This is a wonderful thing Martha is doing. She isn't just running around being just caught up in all of these things for wrong reasons. Here she is. She sought after the Lord, invited him into her house. She's serving him, seeking to minister to him. But Luke gives us another detail that's very important for us to understand where Martha is at. It says that she was distracted with much serving. Now, immediately we can think, okay, here's the negative part about Martha. She's distracted. But you know what this word actually means? It means to be pulled away from or drawn in two directions. Here's Martha longing to be in there with Mary, longing to be in there with the Savior. And yet, what I want to do and what I feel like I need to do are at odds, and I feel torn. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been preparing a big meal for your family? Maybe there is a lot of people over, and I don't know how your house is arranged, so maybe your kitchen is open, you can hear everybody, but imagine that wasn't the case, and you're in there, and you're trying to make this amazing meal to serve the family, and you can hear in the other room all the laughter, all the talking, stories being told, and you're going, oh, I wish I was in there. You almost want to say to everybody, hey, guys, no more good stories until we're done, because I would like to be a part. That's Martha. She wants to be in there. She's longing to be a part. She feels torn. She feels torn between serving Jesus and sitting at his feet. But Luke also tells us some other things that are important for us to see, not just about Martha, but even Mary. If we're going to rightly understand what's happening in this story, let's see how he describes Mary. He says that she is sitting at Jesus' feet. And that is an important term or expression. She's not sitting at his feet simply as an act of submission. She's not just sitting at his feet maybe to do something like wash his feet. She's sitting at his feet for a reason. I know you guys are going through the book of Acts, which you know is the second book in which Luke wrote, the first one being the Gospel of Luke. The second book, just continuing on with the work of Christ, is the book of Acts. And in Acts chapter 22, verse 3, as Paul is telling of his credentials, listen to what he says. He says, I was educated at the feet of Gamaliel. When he talks about his teacher and that he was a disciple of Gamaliel, instead of saying, I was a disciple of this man named Gamaliel, he says, I sat at the feet of Gamaliel. The point being here is that Mary is sitting at the Lord's feet as a disciple. She's taking in what he says. She's learning from him. But there's something here, one other detail that I think is really important for us to see that we may not always see and think about how significant this is, especially in Luke's gospel, and that's in verse 39. It says she sat at his feet and listened to his teaching. I think you guys may use the English Standard Version. I love the English Standard Version, but no version gets everything right. And sadly here, I think the English Standard Version doesn't get it right. It uses the word teaching, but the best word, the word that we should be seeing here is the word logos, word. The New King James Version translates this verse like this. Here is how the New King James renders it. Mary sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. And this is significant because Luke has used that word, logos, the word, 40 times in his gospel. And in some of the places he's used it is very significant. Like in chapter 8, it's a few chapters before this passage, there's a parable that Jesus tells, probably a familiar parable to most of us, the parable of the sower and the soil. And Jesus tells this parable about the kingdom, and he says the kingdom is like this sower who goes out and he's throwing seed, and some of it falls on bad soil, some of it falls on good soil, but it doesn't become fruitful. And then he tells us what the parable is about, and he says the seed in this parable is the word of God. There's that word again, logos, word. Or back in chapter 6, Jesus tells another parable that's built on this idea, this idea of the word logos, the word. Jesus tells the parable of two men building a house. One builds it on the rock, one builds it on the sand. And here's how Jesus says we're to understand this parable. He says, everyone who comes to me and hears my words and does them, I will show you what he is like. And then he goes on to tell that parable. So not only has Luke used this word logos, the word 40 times, but how he has used it leading up to chapter 10, when we get to this point and we hear that Mary is sitting at Jesus' feet listening to the word, we have to go, this is significant. What she is doing is so important. Now that leads us to the third place in our passage. We've listened to Martha's complaint. We've understood, I think we've better understood the descriptions Luke's gave us. Now I think we need to understand Jesus's response to Martha, because now we hear Jesus respond to her after she has come to him and says, do you not care? Are you not concerned? Jesus is going to speak to her. And he begins by saying, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. Notice how Jesus responds to Martha here. He responds to Martha by commending Mary's choice. He doesn't say, Martha, you were wrong in what you did. He commends Mary for what she has chosen. And his reason for doing this is really important, because I'm hoping you're seeing how everything's building and the story's coming together. Because if we've missed how the story's built on Martha's complaint, and we've missed all these details, you know what we could be tempted to think? That Jesus is pitting solitude and study over service. You know, don't be a Martha. It's more important that we have solitude than we serve. That's not what's happening here. That's not what Jesus is wanting to communicate to her, as if her service was not important or not good, or that sitting at his feet was more important than service. No, his reason for commending Mary's choice is it's multifaceted. Here's one reason he's doing this. Jesus wants to show Martha, first and foremost, why her criticism of Mary is unfounded and wrong. Remember, it's Martha's the one who's critiqued him, critiqued Mary, and Jesus, in answering, is wanting her to see your critique of her is wrong. But he also wants her to understand why he will not tell Mary to join her in serving. Remember, that was her last request. Tell my sister to help me. And not only is Jesus defending Mary's actions, but he's saying, no, I'm not going to encourage her to do that, because what she's doing is good. But there's another reason Jesus says these words to her, even the how it begins, by him saying her name two times, you feel his affection for her. See, Jesus isn't just interested in helping Martha understand why he's responding the way he is. You know what he's also wanting to do? He's wanting to care for Martha. He's wanting to care for Martha because Martha is obviously upset. And if you ask Martha, why are you so upset? Do you know what Martha would tell you? She would say, I am so upset because I am serving alone. I am so upset because I am overwhelmed and no one seems to care. Not even the Savior. Here I am seeking to do something to show tangible care for the Savior, and it just seems like nobody's even noticing. And I've got all this stuff to do, and no one's lifting a finger to help me. See, Martha is a woman who right now is anxious and in turmoil, and she's becoming bitter and angry, and there's no joy. And Jesus isn't just saying what he's saying so that she realizes, hey, listen, Mary's not wrong for what she's doing. He's seeking to care for her. Martha, don't you know that you're anxious and troubled because of the choice you've made? You're anxious and troubled because of your own decision. Listen to what Jesus says to her. You are anxious and troubled because you chose to be concerned about many things when Mary chose the one thing that was necessary. Once again, he's not trying to say your service is not important. He's just saying you are so distracted by these many things, but Martha, you're missing it. There's one thing that's necessary, and that's not the thing you're focused on. No wonder you're in this place of anxiousness and anger. Mary has chosen this one thing, the one thing that mattered most. Now this brings us to the primary reason Jesus commends Mary for her decision and the main point of the text. Because if we just stopped here, we could say, okay, I better understand this. Martha is the one bringing the complaint. No one's questioning Mary's decision, or no one's questioning Martha's decision. Everybody's questioning Mary's decision, even Jesus' decision. Okay, I see that more clearly. But what's the point of the story? Why is it here? What's it meant to communicate? If it's not telling us it's more important to have solitude than service, then what's the point? Well, here's what I think the primary point of the passage is for us this morning. If I could put it in a single sentence, it would be like this: receiving from Jesus must always precede our response to Jesus. I'm going to repeat that, and then I want to explain what I mean by that. Receiving from Jesus must always precede our response to Jesus. See, Luke has emphasized all throughout his gospel, and we've seen a few examples of this morning, how we must receive his word and we must respond to his word in order to be a disciple. Think about that parable of the two men building a house. He said, the one who's built his house on the rock has done what? He's the one who's heard my word and he does my word. He's put it into practice. Both are necessary, but we must never get the order confused. We as disciples of Jesus must always be receivers before we can be responders. We must always, as disciples of Jesus, be receivers before we can be responders. And this truth really came out to me as I began to think about the placement of this story in the gospel. One of the things I want to encourage you, and if you're not used to paying attention to, it's a great way to start just getting more from the scriptures and seeing new insights. Every passage of scripture is in the place that it's at in that book for a reason. It's not haphazard. Luke wasn't just writing some things down to think, okay, story, oh yeah, the story of the Good Samaritan. Okay, told that one. What else? There's the Mary and Martha story. The very fact that this story comes after the Good Samaritan story, I think, is really important. And I really believe that the original audience would have caught this. So think for just a minute. If you were reading through this gospel and you've just read the parable of the Good Samaritan, what should come to mind? This lawyer asked Jesus about having everlasting life. Jesus is talking to him about it, and he says to him, you need to love your neighbor as yourself. And the good lawyer trying to find a way to kind of get around that says, well, who is my neighbor? And then Jesus tells this parable of the good Samaritan. What does it look like to be a good neighbor? And here's how the parable ends. Jesus says, you go and do likewise. So the whole parable is about loving your neighbor. Here was this man that was hurt on the road, and all these people passed him by except for this one good Samaritan. And Jesus says, who was a good neighbor to him? Well, the Samaritan was. And Jesus says to his disciples, now you go and do it. You go and do likewise. Then, very next story, here's Martha paying attention to Jesus as he comes down the road on his way to Jerusalem to die. And what does she do? She is a great neighbor. She is showing him the very thing Jesus was commending in the parable before. She is loving him. She is inviting him into her home. She is showing him the kind of hospitality he was commending in the parable before. And I think Luke is doing something here that's really important. He's saying there are some of us that we need to remember, we need to respond to God's word. And one of the ways we respond to God's word is we need to love our neighbor as ourselves. There are some of us who need to be reminded that we are called to be doers. But there are Marthas. Martha has no problem with the doing. Martha's a good doer. Martha's a great responder. But Martha has neglected the order of things. See, Martha is a responder, but she wasn't first a receiver. She is loving Jesus. She is doing everything she should be doing, except she's seeking to minister to Jesus, but she hasn't yet been ministered to by Jesus. I think the original audience would have read this and caught this. And I think it's a significant point for us all. Yes, there are many of us who maybe we need reminders and prodding that there are things about the scriptures. We're not just to be hearers of the word, but we're to be doers. But I wonder this morning, as I was praying about our time this morning, I wonder this morning if there are not many Marthas here. You're good at doing. You thrive at doing. You get an A+ in the category of doing. But I wonder if you spend all your time ministering, but you very rarely are being ministered to by Jesus. And I wonder if you're like Martha this morning. And in all you're doing and in all you're serving, which is so commendable and so wonderful, maybe you're serving your family, maybe you're serving a sick child, maybe you're serving a sick spouse, maybe you're serving a sick parent, maybe you're just going through a really difficult time in your life and you are serving and you are doing. But I wonder if there's not some here this morning that is, as I was describing Martha, you were looking in the mirror. Because just like Martha, you're not just doing, you are stressed. You are joyless. And the very ones you seek to serve are regularly the objects of your anger and your frustration. And if someone was to stop you and say, why are you so upset? You would say, because nobody ever appreciates me. Nobody ever helps me. Nobody ever sees the things I do. Is that you this morning? Can you relate to Martha? I can. This morning, I want to encourage everyone here, especially those who are feeling like this, You're a server. You're a doer. But you can't remember the last time you were just sitting at Jesus' feet being ministered to, and you're feeling the effect of it on your soul. I just want to encourage you that Jesus wants to commend you for your service, but he also wants to tell you, be a receiver first and a responder second. He's not in any way wanting to make light of your service. But Jesus, like he cared for Martha, wants to care for you this morning, and he wants to tell you, sit down at my feet for a little while. Sit down and hear from me. Let me care for you. And you know the place that we receive the care of Jesus? Alongside of prayer, we receive the care of Jesus in the Bible. When we're in Scripture, this is the place that our Savior speaks to us. Are you getting the care of the Savior? And I want to frame it that way because some of you this morning are maybe going through such a hard time and you are really in a difficult season of caring for people. You barely have a moment to yourself, and you could hear this and think, oh great, one more thing to do. On top of serving anybody else, make sure you're reading your Bible. I'm not here this morning to add on another burden. If anything, I want to see that your burden's lifted, and I want to tell you, Jesus wants to minister to you in his word. He cares for you, and your service is precious to him. Like Martha's service was precious to him. But the one thing Martha needed most was the thing she was neglecting. And Jesus just wanted to say to her, Martha, there's one thing that's necessary. All these other things aren't bad, but there's one thing that's necessary. So, ultimately, Jesus' commendation of Mary's choice wasn't meant to draw attention to Mary or to Martha. Jesus' commendation of Mary's choice was meant to draw attention to the primacy of his words and our need for them. See, this story isn't about Mary and Martha. It's about Jesus' word and how much we need it and how central it should be in our life. So this morning, I want to close by speaking the Savior's words over us this morning. And I'm praying this morning as I do this, I really believe there are some here this morning, you are burdened and you are feeling the effects of serving but not sitting at Jesus' feet. And I want you to hear his words to you this morning. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke, it is easy, and my burden, it's light. Let's pray. Father, I know you know every heart in this place this morning. And no one cares for the people that are sitting in this room this morning more than you do. And I'm fully aware of that. As much as I want to minister and care, I know that, Lord, I'm only an extension of your care, and I know that your care is beyond our understanding. You love us and want to care for us and sustain us. And Father, there are some here this morning that needs sustaining. And they're sustaining, the sustaining grace that they need, Lord, comes in the way that maybe we don't always think about. They're not running from you. They're not trying to serve or do. They're just like Martha. They're doing. They're pressing on. But in the midst of it, Lord, they are tired and weary, and their souls need rest. Father, would you grant rest to every heart here this morning? Whatever burdens we carry, whatever struggles we're facing, whatever obstacles there may be right now in this season of life, I pray that we will take you up on your word and we will receive this invitation to come to you and cast all of our heavy burden upon you, and that we would rest in you and we would listen to you and we would sit at your feet and be refreshed. Father, if there's anyone here this morning that has not put their trust in you, I pray that they would hear from the songs that have been sung this morning, to the exhortation, to the sermon, that, Lord, they do not have to do something to be right with you. You've done what was necessary. All they need to do is respond to the message after they've received the message of grace. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for this sweet reminder. I pray that, Father, as the word has gone out, that it has ministered and it will bear fruit for the good of your people and to the glory of your name. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.